Hello everyone, my name is Tapasya and let's begin with our today's session, that is on Northrop Frye. Northrop Frye is associated with archetypal literature, but he is also associated with Canadian literature. Now in this lecture, we are going to learn about both the type of his learning in Canadian literature and archetypal school of thoughts. So let's begin with the major books that Northrop Frye had written, and from few of the books we are going to know his concepts. So starting with his first book, the first book is Anatomy of Criticism. In this there are four essays. So the first essay is known as Historical Criticism: Theory of Modes. Historical Criticism: Theory of Modes. Second essay is Ethical Criticism: Theory of Symbols. Ethical Criticism: Theory of Symbols. Next is Archetypal Criticism: Theory of Myths. Archetypal Criticism: Theory of Myths, M-Y-T-H-S. Fourth essay is Rhetorical Criticism: Theory of Genre. Rhetorical Criticism: Theory of Genre. Now moving on to his next work, that is Fearful Symmetry. Fearful Symmetry. You should know that this particular work was being taken from William Blake's work, and this is the reinterpretation of the poem of William Blake's. Then there is the third work by Northrop Frye, that is Great Code. Great Code, C-O-D-E. There are two volume study in this Great Code, that is Underpinning the Bible in the Western Literature. So there is the Western Literature and Bible. Okay, so Bible is the symbolic thing in this work, and it is into two volumes. Then the last work, that is Bush Garden: Essay on Canadian Imagination. So this work relates with the Canadian writing and painting. Bush Garden: Essays on Canadian Imagination. Now moving on to the concepts, we'll be dealing with the three concepts given by Northrop Frye. The first concept is four kinds of literature. So in the first concept, Northrop Frye divides literature in two categories, that is comedic and second is tragic. Each category is further divided into two more categories, two subcategories, that is in comedic you will have comedy and romance as the subcategory or a subdivision, and in tragic you will have tragedy and satire. Okay, so while writing satire you can also put a slant line and write there irony. Okay, so comedic is comedy and romance, tragic is tragedy, satire and irony. Okay, so two from tragic and two from comedic. Now he further explains that he says that the four kinds of literature, that is comedy, romance, tragedy and satire, can be linked with four seasons. Okay, so these four seasons would be the archetypal schema. For example, summer can be compared with romance, autumn can be compared with tragedy, winter can be compared with satire, okay, and spring could be compared with comedy. So in these four categories, we find a particular pattern followed, right? Like in every novel, okay, we start with the summer, which shows romance or the birth of hero. So in autumn, okay, so in a novel, when there is autumn, there is the movement towards the death of the hero. If there is a winter in the novel, the hero is absent. Or in a novel, when there is a spring going on, there would be a rebirth of hero. So this concept is said by Northrop Frye. He says that we should compare our four types of category, that is comedy, romance, satire and tragedy, with four types of reason. And you'll always see that in any of the movie or any of the novel, that when there is summer, there is romance. When there is autumn, there are movements of the death of the hero. Okay, like you might have seen lots of leaves that have been falling, okay, with the death of any of the hero. So everything is interconnected. Every season is interconnected with our moods, okay, with comedy, tragedy, satire and romance. So moving on to the next concept. In the next concept, he tells us about the five types of spheres, spheres, okay, in which there are five types. First is human, second is animal, third is vegetation, fourth is mineral and fifth is water. Okay, so human, animal, vegetation, mineral and water. Now in comedic, the first type that we have learned, the world is seen to be as a wish-fulfilling. Okay, whenever we see a comedy movie or any comedy act, we see the world seem to be very, you know, fulfilling, where the wish are getting fulfilled. Okay, but on the other hand, in tragic world, in tragic movie, the world is full of isolation or irony, or there is a dictatorship. Okay, so there is difference that we could follow. So we could find this comedic and tragic in what type of sphere? That is the first type, that is human. So in human, what with us, when we compare with us, when we are very happy, there will be lot of comedy. When we are sad, when we are isolated, okay, or when life is giving, you know, playing with us in an ironic form, we will always be in a tragic mode. Okay, then comes the second sphere, it is animal. Now animal in comedy genre are pastoral, for example sheep, and animal in tragic genre are hunters, wolves. Okay, all the wild animals are counted in the tragic genre. So what you need to understand is, when we read any of the comedy novel and when we read any of the tragedy novel, you will find these similarities and these concepts that we are learning today, right? When we read a comedy thing, if there are animals, you will see sheep, okay, all the herbivorous animals. And if you read any of the tragedies, okay, if you read that genre, you'll find hunters, wolves and all the carnivorous animals. So moving on to the third type, that is vegetation. Now in this type, comedy is again pastoral, okay, and we will have garden, park, roses, lotus, okay, all such types of vegetation. And if we see vegetation in tragedy, there we will find wild forest, barren land. Okay, now these things represent tragedy. Fine. Moving on to the fourth type, that is mineral. Now in comedy, if you want to show mineral or if you read about minerals, there might be precious stones in comedy. But on the other hand, if you read any tragedy related to minerals, it will talk about the ruins of any of the stone. For example, you could give the fort of Chittorgarh. Okay, you could if I talk about Chittorgarh, I am not going to comedy. I'm not going to talk about any of the comedy thing in that particular fort because it's a ruined fort. It has been destroyed. So what I'm going to talk about is about the destruction, about the tragedy. Okay, then comes the last type, that is water. So in water, it is... So moving on to the last type, that is water. Now in water, the comedy, if we see, there will be rivers. Okay, if you read any of the novel related to comedy, you would find water as a river. But if you read tragedy, there will be floods, there will be seas. Okay, S-E-A-S. That you will find in tragedy and comedy. Now, you will see different symbols for different literature, right? If you read any lament or ode, you would see hunters, isolations. So with every mood, we have everything that is compared and related to it. We can directly associate those things with our moods and with comedy and tragedy. So Northrop Frye is actually comparing comedy and tragedy with everything. Okay, so he tried and built up with five types of spears, and also the four important seasons, which can be related to the four types of categories. Okay, now coming to the last and the important concept of Northrop Frye is about the Canadian literature and its criticism. Canadian literature and its criticism. Now, we all know that he is a writer from Canada. Okay, and Canadian literature is having garrison mentality. G-A-R-R-I-S-O-N. Now, what do you mean by garrison mentality? Why did he say that Canadian literature has a garrison mentality? Now, in a written text, okay, by the writer, characters always look outwards, okay, and they are building metaphorical wall in outside world. Now, what do you mean by metaphorical walls? Now, this mentality is assumed to have the fear and emptiness. So, metaphorical wall is what? When you are mentally empty and fear, okay, of landscapes. Correct? So, garrison mentality is actually related to the metaphorical walls and also to the characters who look outwards. Okay, it is not that beautiful country. It is said, Northrop Frye says that Canada is not exactly a beautiful country. Okay, then Canada was colonized by United States for a long time, all of these people living in Canada feared of oppression actually. Okay, from other nation, and that is why it is symbolic for the people living in Canada that they might have a metaphorical wall built around them, which is of actually imagination. Correct? Why? Because they have felt the feeling of being colonized, okay, being suppressed, being oppressed. So they fear, and this fear of having someone again overruling us, overpowering us, is known as garrison mentality. So the term garrison mentality was first coined by Northrop Frye and was further used by Margaret Atwood in her book Survival: A Thematic Guide of Canadian Literature. Fine. So after Northrop Frye used the term garrison mentality, the further study was done by Margaret Atwood in her work, that is Survival: A Thematic Guide to Canadian Literature. Okay, this was the first thing that we have learnt about the Canadian literature, that is about garrison mentality. Now, about the second thing that we are going to learn about the Canadian literature is strangled articulateness. Strangled articulateness. Sorry. A-R-T-I-Q-U-L-A-T-N-E-S-S. Articulateness. Okay, so strangled means what? If you know, strangle means trying hard to happen the things. Okay, for example, if I give you the example of Porphyria's lovers. In this, she was strangled by her lovers. Okay, so it is what? Trying hard to happen the things. That is strangled. Zabardasti koi cheez ko cheez ke liye bahar nikalte rehna. ठीक है कि ये होना ही चाहिए इस तरह. और आर्टिकुलेटनेस इज व्हाट द एबिलिटी टू राइट और स्पीक फ्लुएंटली. सो ही सेज व्हेन अ राइटर इज नॉट एबल टू फ्लुएंटली राइट और स्पीक हिज थॉट द राइटर फ्रॉम कैनेडा आर सफरिंग फ्रॉम स्ट्रैंगल्ड आर्टिकुलेटनेस. व्हाई? बिकॉज दे आर नॉट एबल टू एक्सप्रेस देयर थॉट्स बिकॉज ऑफ गैरिसन मेंटालिटी. So two terms which have been together combined, okay, where Northrop Frye gives us a good term about garrison mentality and strangle articulateness. So I hope you might have understood the audio. There were few questions being asked. The first question is, who among the following is a Canadian critic? So it is Northrop Frye out of many of the options that were given. Which of the following are not mentioned in the four generic plot? So it is lyric. There were few options given. You can Google it out and you'll get all the options. Which of the following are not mentioned in four generic plot, and that is lyric. So four generic plot is what? According to him, there are four seasons. So four categories are the generic plot. That is comedy, tragedy, romance and satire. Then there was Match the Pair that was being asked, where Anatomy of Criticism was perfectly matched with Northrop Frye. Now there was one more question, that is Northrop Frye influencing work Anatomy of Criticism mentions four essay. Which of the following is not among them? And the options were archetypal, topographical, historical and ethical. So the correct option is topographical. Archetypal, obviously Northrop Frye belongs to the archetypal school of thoughts. Historical, because we have learnt about so many destructions and the ruins of the stones, that is vegetation, okay, or you could say that is stones. Then comes ethical. Okay, so these three types, that is archetypal, historical and ethical, are the influencing works of Northrop Frye, and then topographical is not. Writing about his essays, the fourth work that is not mentioned here is rhetorical. Right, so historical, ethical and archetypal is given, and the correct option would be rhetorical if there was been mentioned the fourth one correct. So all four would be the correct one. So that's all for this lecture. Thank you so much.